out there, whether you are a mother to a human or a beast, happy Mother's Day. So, and see, I'm just going to welcome visitors, but we are all family today. So welcome, family. Our theme today is being ready to tell our story and why we hope, have hope in us that can be seen by others. So I'll start by telling a quick part of my story that you may or may not know. And it is in relation to our very first hymn, In the Garden. In the Garden, if you've known me for any length of time, you know, is my absolute number one. It would be on any of those like Spotify lists, it would always be the number one up there. And that's because it was the one my grandma taught me. Now, she didn't play the piano, or so she said. She taught me two songs. One was I Dropped My Dolly in the Dirt, which was a very clever song, and I cannot remember it to this day, and it is killing me, because I've been trying for years to remember. I know the first line. If any of you happen to know that song, please see me afterwards. And the other one was In the Garden. So obviously, there was a wide variance in abilities there of that. But she didn't play it like Denise plays it, or my uncle played the piano and was a beautiful musician. And it wasn't the way he did, but it was the way she did. It was much more plucker version of In the Garden. But we would take a bath because Sunday was for church. So good old Baptist upbringing. And we spent the night, we take a bath Saturday night because you had to clean for church. Not the rest of the week, Sunday morning you had to clean. And we would, afterwards, of course my hair was down to here then in those days, so we'd take forever to dry. So we would sit at the piano and we would sing either I Dropped My Dolly in the Dirt, or we would sing In the Garden. And it was just one of those times that always made me feel special. I knew it was a special quiet time. The house was dark. We were getting ready for bed. And then it was also one of those songs. And some of you may know, it was the funeral song. It started down at Johnson's funeral home with my dad when I was 15 and a half. And I had held it together until that song, and I lost it, completely in a ball, on the floor, lost it. Both of my grandmothers coming to try and get me up off the sobbing floor and into the chair. Then, a few years later, it was played at my grandfather's funeral. And then a year later, my grandma who taught me's funeral, and a year after that, my other grandmother's funeral. It took me, I think, probably 15 years of being in this church, singing it between Debbie and I almost every week. Wasn't it, Denise? As a permanent priest in most of your hymnals out there. Before I could listen to that song without crying, because I can never get through the first verse. I can now sing it, we'll see how I do later in just a minute, if I do or not. But it was just one of those stories, a little bit of my grandmother telling me her story without telling me her story. And it's something that I've told my kids. They know this song because of that. Eventually I'll tell Isabella and Michael. They may need a few more years before they understand, but I'll get there. But it's that part of why I love music. I love music. I don't sing well, but it's how I learn things. And there's so many songs I know right by heart, and it takes me right back to the different parts of my faith that I could tell easier than I could try putting it into my own words. So I don't know if any of that has made sense or not to you, but it's being able to tell your part of your story. You don't have to tell the whole thing, but just a little bit when somebody asks you about that hope. So that's what we're going to be talking about today. So please stand and let's see if we can get through this song without the tears.
I got a transforming God, you have taken the world's darkness, recreated a world filled with the joy of light and hope.
Come and hear the good news of God's love for all creation.
Restoring God, you have turned defeat into sudden victory and recreated a world filled with the joy of peace and shalom.
Come and hear the good news of God's awesome powers.
Renewing God, we respond to your mighty deeds with songs of praise, worship, and thankful prayers. You alone are God.
Come and hear the good news of God's blessings on us all.
Glory and honor, power and dominion belong to God alone.
Amen.
When you guys get back, And we are going to miss you guys while you're gone.
Yeah.
Me too.
3 weeks? Oh, we're going to be so sad that you're not going to be here for 3 weeks. Anyway. For us, who aren't on this trip of a lifetime, getting to see all new things and a whole bunch of family, it's a long time. For you guys, it probably won't be enough time to do everything that you guys want to do. But I'm sure you guys will come back with lots of good stories. So let's stand and say a prayer for our moms before we go to Sunday school. Lifting to you the joys and concerns. hopes and dreams of our lives. May we also be open to your voice in our lives, that we may see with new eyes and hear with new ears the direction that you will have us go. Bless, we pray, this gathering of your people, but that we may grow and flourish in your love and grace for the purpose to which you have called us. Hear our prayers for those whose lives have touched us, those who are in pain, those who are ill, those who grieve. We lift those names to you now.
Jeff.
The Benz family.
Matthew, Chris, and Mike.
Touch their lives, not only through our prayers, but through our lives and actions as well. Guide us, bless us, uplift us, and hold us. For we are your children, called to our purpose in the world. Hear our prayers, those spoken and those hidden in our hearts. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who revealed your will to us and taught us to pray to you as one family, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
and suffering for their faith. The writer does this by reminding his readers of the good news about Jesus Christ, whose death, resurrection, and promised coming give them hope. In the light of this, they are to accept and endure their suffering, confident that it is the test of genuineness of their faith, and that they will be rewarded on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed. Along with this encouragement in a time of trouble, the writer also urges readers to live as people who belong to Christ. So, the reading is from 1 Peter, it's verses 13 through 22 in chapter 3. If the heart and soul were doing good, you would think that you could be stopped. Even if you suffer for it, you're still better off. Don't give the opposition a second thought. Through thick and thin, keep your hearts at attention, in adoration before Christ your Master. Be ready to speak up and tell anyone who asks why you are living the way you are, and always with the utmost courtesy. Keep a clear conscience before God, so that when people throw mud at you, none of it will stick. They will end up realizing that they're the ones that need a bath. It's better to suffer from doing good, that's what God wants, than to be punished for doing bad. That's what Christ did definitely, suffering because of other sins, the righteousness one for the unrighteous ones. He went through it all. He was put to death and then made alive to bring us to God. He went and proclaimed God's salvation to earlier generations who ended up in prison of judgment because they wouldn't listen. You know, even though God waited patiently all the days that Noah built his ship, only a few were saved, there were eight to be exact, saved from the water, by the water. The waters of baptism do that for you, not by washing away the dirt from your skin, but by presenting you through Jesus' resurrection before God with a clear conscience. Jesus has the last word on everything and everyone, from angels to armies. He's standing right alongside God, and what he says goes. The reading of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, John. So, do you have a list? Now, who will harm you if you're eager to do good? Well, Peter, I will give you a list. You know, that verse is a little naive, don't you think, that people are trying to hurt those doing good all the time? Think of aid workers in the times of war, or those trying to help the hurting and totalitarian regimes, or those attempting to stand up against injustice, even in representative democracies who suffer persecution and misrepresentation on a regular basis. We could come up with quite a list. But then maybe Peter is aware of all of that, which is why he moves on from verse 13 and immediately says, but even if you do suffer for doing what is right, in the very next verse, maybe he's more aware of the world in which we live in than it seems at first. Of course he is. This is Peter, or represents something of Peter's thinking, an example. Then yes, he does understand a complicated world. He goes on to say, don't live in fear. Don't hesitate to do good. And don't let the threats cause you to not do what your faith has called you to do and to be. Always ready to make your defense is a powerful statement about the need to be over Christians in a world that has become cynical, let alone dangerous. What a challenge given to us, to the church, to be prepared to speak, to give account for the hope that's within us. It's a call not to be quiet, to not keep things under our hats, but to live out loud in a way that draws attention to what we are doing and who we are, and most importantly, to why we do what we do. This is a call to evangelism. Okay, don't panic now. My next statement. To knocking on doors, and I'm not necessarily asking you to go and do that, because I know how this congregation feels about that, and telling our story. So no, I'm not going to ask you today to go knock on your neighbor's door and just share your story right away. Don't worry. True, it says, to give a defense to anyone who deems and demands an account. Some see that as an out. Well, as long as nobody asks me, I don't have to tell my story, and I don't have to do anything, right? Well, we could also argue that the world is demanding an account all the time. Certainly, the brokenness of the world demands an account. The emptiness of the world demands an account. The hunger of the world demands an account. We believe that we have what the world needs. How dare we keep it just to ourselves? Now, Peter is quick to tell us how to go about doing good. We don't do it with anger. We don't do it with force and annoyance, with tricks or sleight of hand. No, we need to do it with gentleness and reverence, he writes, and to tell the honest truth as you know it. Don't make stuff up or you're going to get caught, says Peter. Maybe that's because he has some personal experience with that. Don't say you're brave when you're not. Don't say you won't run when you might. And don't say you're perfect when you and probably everyone else who knows you are the chief of sinners. Sorry, that was Paul. That was a whole other P name in the New Testament. But you get the point. Peter says we need to speak with integrity. We speak as those who did not deserve the grace by which we live, but who were baptized into a new life and a new way of living. We speak as those who are being made into disciples of Jesus Christ, not as those who have finished their labors. We are under condemnation of death, Peter writes, and Jesus came and set us free. This is the context from which we speak, from which we give an account of the hope that's within us, not by our own merits or by our own goodness, but by the grace of God in Christ. The psalmist in Psalm 66 tells a similar story, but instead of suffering, the psalm speaks of being tested as silver is tested. Indeed, the psalm speaks of all sorts of difficulties and struggles as having a divine origin. Yet the attitude of the writer is not one of frustration or anger, but understanding and a willingness to praise. Rather than casting blame, the psalm suggests that there's no human experience that is outside the will of God. There is nothing that can or does happen to us that is a sign that God has abandoned us. I'm going to read that one again. There is nothing that can or does happen to us that is a sign that God has abandoned us, even though sometimes it definitely feels like he is not there right now. In the end, we could argue that the witness here is that God is present even in our difficult times. Our understanding of the activity of God in our lives is different from that of writers of Hebrew scriptures, which is why it sounds odd or uncomfortable to us. For the psalmist to say that God has laid the burdens and God let the people ride over their heads is the good news of God's presence in the midst of pain and suffering. The result of this understanding is that the writer will speak of God's goodness. The psalmist will tell what God has done for me, like Peter's call. Psalm 66 says that we must always be ready to make a defense for the hope that lies within. And given the difficulties faced, there's no doubt that there will be those who ask, how can you still have hope? So, come and hear, all who fear God, and I will tell you what God has done for me. But notice one more thing about this telling. Nowhere does it ask us to count the numbers who believe us. Nowhere is there supposed to be a measuring of the response of the words to those spoken. Psalm 66 tells us that God has listened. And in the end, that is the audience from whom we speak. That is the measure of our faithfulness. Not how many souls have we saved, not the crowds that we drew to the attention we gathered. In fact, it may seem like no one at all is responding. It's turning their lives around or is making any changes that were based on our words. That doesn't matter in the least. that part made me feel a little more reassured. No matter who listens to me, I don't have to worry if anybody has heard me that week. I just need to keep speaking. Yes, of course, we hope to make a difference in the world around us. We hope to bring the influence for the cause of Christ and to make disciples of Jesus for the transformation of the world. But in the end, our audience is God. Our measuring rod is faithfulness to the call of God, and God will take care of the response. Our task is to always be ready to give a defense to anyone who sees the hope within us. Now, some of you have heard my story, and luckily I don't have to have an answer why. I just have to say what my story is, and maybe somebody will get the why. When my dad died when I was 15 and a half, a plane crash, he'd been missing for a week. And I remember praying that Thursday night that we have to find him because we knew another blizzard was coming into the Sierras, and that would mean that all search would be cut off, and we would not be able to start looking again, probably till middle to the end of the summer, because then you'd have to wait for the snow to melt. And I just said, okay, God, I know he's not alive anymore. Can you just help us find him? I don't want this to keep going on. I was 15 and a half. What the heck did I know about preaching, about praying, about any of this stuff? I just knew from mostly in the garden is the one I knew. But somehow that song had enough of the words that told me I need to keep praying no matter what. I never blamed God in that moment. And don't ask me why I didn't, because the rest of my family did. No. My brother will not go to church, won't even talk about God because of it. So it did turn one of us, but it didn't turn me. But I don't know why. I always felt like I had to have a why. Like, who would listen to me talking about what I was like as a 15-year-old if I didn't have the because, dot, 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 and go on. But I felt very much reassured that I really haven't had the answer all these years. I may not get the answer, hoping maybe I'll get the answer when I get to heaven, if I get lucky enough to do that. But those stories, you never know who needs to hear that, at what time. And you may not know the reason, but they may. And that's why we tell our stories. So, it's not just me up here, it's not just Linda up here, but when you guys get up here and you help tell the stories, it just gives us a broader case of what Jesus and God world is. Remember our former pastor, Ted Paco, used to say that when you meet somebody, you get to know God better. That each of us has a piece of God in them. And we can't get to know God better until we get to know that peace. And when we get to know that, we then get to know God just a little bit better. And if we start treating each other as if they are God, the peace of God is there, we might be able to change this ship right around. Just like before we started, we were very heavy on this side of the church. Only a couple people sitting over here. We seem to have right at this ship as we went through this service. So, don't be afraid to tell your story, even if it's just a little bit. Sometimes you have to tell the story over and over because you have to practice. This isn't making it up, it's just sometimes the stories are really hard to tell at first. And it takes a while. And believe me, 20 years ago I couldn't have told you this story without breaking down in tears too. So, it's stuff that you get better at, so that the person who's hearing you can hear your story. Amen?
Amen.
Invite our elders to come forward to receive.
today, we thank you for the work of Bread for the World. They work so that no one will be hungry. Each year, Bread for the World focuses on programs that provide tangible results. We thank you that we can join in the work of Bread for the World. Our letters show our caring through taking action with our commons. One letter alone would not be able to make a difference, but our letters combined with letters from all over our country gain support from our representatives in commons.
Lord, we come to dedicate the letters that we have written and sent. We dedicate these letters to the efforts of fighting hunger and pray that our actions will be pleasing to you. Bless each person who took the time to write a letter. May these letters be a tangible symbol of your presence in our lives. Let us continue to serve you in this world where the need is great. We ask your blessing on these letters. And the people all said,
amen. Yeah, just because we've dedicated the letters today doesn't mean that if you didn't get it or forgot that it's too late. You can still always write, because we're not taking this up until
September.
So you have plenty of time. Talk to your friends and family. Let's see if we can get some more push.
I have lots of information. If you want to get some from me today, it's very easy to send an email if that's your preference. And I want to say that the response was beyond our committee's expectations. There were at least 20 people who wrote one letter or more. So, considering the size of our congregation.
Yeah. Especially since there was only 30 people here last week. So that's pretty good. But if you want to make that even better, because I know we're also a little bit of a competitive bunch, see Susan, she'll get you more of the information if you don't already have it, or email me at the office and I will get that information to you. Are there celebrations besides this glorious Mother's Day? I guess not. We know we had
Ted's home.
Ted's home. We definitely missed your smiling face in church. And Denise had a birthday.
Yeah.
I know we said some of these last week, but Nancy is her birthday buddy. Yeah. Nancy had her birthday last week on the 8th. Also, I heard she's going to be here next week. So we can make sure, I'll say it again next week so we can wish her happy birthday then. And Abe had his birthday on the 10th. And then again, Steve and Susan had their anniversary on the 9th. So it was a very busy week. So, any other celebrations? Anything? We'll take anything. Going once, going twice? No? Okay, announcements. We have on the end of the back of your bulletin, Pastor Linda is in Scotland for her trip to go there, and she'll be gone for the next 2 weeks. If you happen to have a pastoral emergency that you need help with, either text me or email me at the office, and I have pastors' names that I can get you in touch with, or if you just need to make me aware of something, let me know, and we'll get that all taken care of. So I will be speaking with you again next week. And if you'd like to bring altar flowers, whoever brought the beautiful roses this morning, they're gorgeous.
Sandra,
Sandra, they're beautiful. Thank you.
Happy Mother's Day.
Thank you. Beautiful, beautiful. But if you would like to bring flowers for a special occasion in honor or memory of somebody, we have a sign-up sheet out on the I Can Do It table. And you can have that week that's empty. Fill it on up and bring flowers for that week. And any other announcements? Yes, Sandra.
If anybody needs a bouquet, they can have the whole thing. Like if you're going to some event, you're like, oh, I forgot to bring flowers. Go
United. Anybody else? I hear, yes, Janet. Thank you. Mike, I'm totally worried today, so thank you.
Don't you know all these beautiful pictures are from the Filoli Gardens in San Mateo up here in Crystal Springs?
Nice.
This is one of the little paths that goes through the community garden.
Thank you.
I was wondering where, when I looked at the Dave always sends out, here's the signs for this week, and it's like, what pretty pictures are going to be on there today? So thank you very much. Okay, please stand now for our closing hymn, number 666, Shalom to You.
Ha ha.